Welcome, welcome. I think it stopped snowing. It was snowy again for a while. So you are aware, we are being taped, videotaped as well. This will be on cable. So if you're going to ask a question or comment, be aware it is for everyone to see, possibly. You may want to edit yourself. I've had some embarrassing moments. Not for me, but when the son watches the thing on TV and realizes he was being asked about. Or the wife. I am Dr. Michael Maniacci. Welcome. We are here to talk about the impact of fathering. How has your day been so far?
Real good. Are you guys down?
All right. I am here with you until 12:20. And then at 12:25, I'm in here again, and we're doing a second version, basically, of this, of parenting, by talking about birth order. If birth order is the effect siblings have upon each other, this workshop is the effect fathers have upon children. This workshop is getting dated. I redo the research every year or two, and it's getting more and more sparse for a very basic reason. The roles are shifting. It is getting harder and harder to find material which is purely father-based. Much, much more we're finding it's parenting, not necessarily fathering. There are still two major factors where gender seems to play a difference, and one minor factor. But I doubt in 5 years if this workshop will be relevant. The roles are shifting. There is an entire generation which is about to have kids called metrosexuals. I'm sure many of you have heard that term. Most don't know what it means. It has nothing to do with sexual behavior. It means androgyny, basically, where dads are as expected to change diapers and be emotion coaches as mom are too. Work at the house and all that. So it's getting blurry. If you want to know about dads and what the research shows, it basically comes to three issues. Something known as gender guiding lines, emotion coaching, and boundaries. Let's explain. Regardless of how androgynous the culture becomes, same sex, where the distinction between masculine and feminine is decreasing every decade, decade and a half, we can't escape the fact that we still come in two sexes. As long as we come in two sexes, you have to adopt the child's point of view. From the child's point of view, under the age of six, an error frequently occurs. What do I mean by that? A very wise psychiatrist once wrote, "Children are excellent observers, but horrible interpreters. They tend to look up. One of the first things they notice when they look up at mother and father is that, wow, you're different. Even if you have two fathers or two mothers, non-traditional households, they still look at their friends, their siblings, their sisters, their brothers, and say, we come in two sexes. As soon as they realize that, they begin a process called attribution. All attribution means is assigning cause to effects. A very famous psychiatrist in 1930 once discussed that when he was 3 years old, it was one of the first times he wandered out of his home in New York. And he was fascinated when he saw a dog walk up to a fire hydrant and lift its leg and start to urinate, because at that very moment, a fire truck comes screaming by with the siren on, and he jumped about 12 feet. As soon as he calmed down, the dog moved on, and guess what else moved on? And he was firmly convinced that every time a dog urinated on a fire hydrant, a fire truck would come. And he spent the entire day following that dog, and it never urinated on a fire hydrant again. On a tree, on a bush, but not on. And of course, no fire truck came by, so he thought it was a, and he couldn't wait every day until that happened again. In trying to establish cause and effect, he made a leap. That the dog led to, that's what children do. When it comes to gender guiding lines, they sometimes assume that if dad does this, it might be masculine. If mom does this, it might be, when in reality, it could simply be luck, could simply be coincidence. And that begins the process of solidifying or constructing the notion of gender, which is different than sex. Sex is male or female. Gender is masculine or feminine. You cannot escape the fact that we come in two sexes. When they start to notice differences, which may not be based upon gender, it may be based upon, my wife is a hell of a lot better cook than I am. That's why she cooks. Has nothing to do with masculine or feminine. But my daughter, our daughter, may assume, wow, women cook. Now, gender guiding lines, to understand how this plays out, I need to show you the difference between a gender guiding line and a role model. If this is a role model, and this is a gender guiding line, we have two circles. A gender guiding line has to do with all the expectations you have for what it means to be masculine or feminine. Almost always, they are unconscious. Now, what does unconscious mean? One basic thing, preverbal. Or in some instances, nonverbal. That's all it means. There are many things all of us learn we don't learn linguistically. The most famous example I always talk about is tying a shoelace. Hardly anyone learns that verbally. People learn that visually and spatially. For most right-handers, for all right-handers, that means this part of the brain. You don't learn it here, where speech and language is concerned. Most of what we observe and attribute to fathers or mothers is nonverbal, visual, spatial, attitudinal. Gender guiding lines, very few are verbal. They're attitudinal, postural, gestural. Not only are they nonverbal, unconscious, they tend to be future-oriented in terms of shoulds. This is what a man should do. This is what a woman should do. When a man does this, it might be assumed men should do this. And last, they have a quality which sounds like destiny. And we'll tend to say to ourselves, if I'm not careful, I will become like. I have to watch so that I. The most common example I can give you is if you've ever had a father or a mother who drank too much. If it's your father, and except for one, we have women in here, you might assume not that father drank, but that men drank. You won't know you made that distinction. You may then say, I have to be, say the word, careful. Real men drink. I saw what it did to him. That has the potential to be my destiny. Unless, please, come on in. Oh, okay. And you will operate as if that were your destiny. And you will develop all sorts of strange fantasies about that. Timetables. See, gender guiding lines set pace as well. How many of you had a father who died fairly young? Changed careers. How old was your father?
When he changed careers, it was 55. Early retirement forced, that kind of thing.
When was he retired? At 55?
Well, they forced it.
Yeah. Forced, yeah.
And changed careers, yeah.
Now, don't be surprised, Kevin, is as you approach your mid-50s, you start expecting a career change. Mm-hmm. How old are you?
53.
You're thinking about a career change, aren't you? Yeah.
Had one forced on me on Friday, actually. New job. We're in the same company.
Congratulations and my condolences.
It worked out okay, yeah.
But you see what I'm saying? And we develop these timetables that we don't verbally realize. Gentlemen, how old was your father when he met your mother? You got a rough number in your head?
Mm-hmm. In their 20s.
Can you narrow it down?
I think my father was 24 and my mom
22.
But 25.
Do not be surprised if around 25, 22, I think you said, about 25, 24, you started looking for Miss Wright. You don't know why, but you'll have this funny notion, I've had enough of dating, it's time to what? Now, you may not settle down because she may not be there. So what you'll find yourself doing is you'll start dating the wrong woman. And you won't know why. Because it's the right time. That doesn't mean it's the right person. So you will attempt to fit a square peg into a round hole because the time said so. Now, these big numbers are all part of these gender guiding line messages. When to start working, when to stop working, when to change careers, when to settle down, when to divorce, if that's when your parents divorced, when to die. It's fascinating stuff. Anybody have a father who had an accident or a major illness? Fairly young. That will play out. Because when you approach that number, you'll start getting worried, nervous. If that's a gender guiding line, that is to be distinguished from a role model. If this is nonverbal, unconscious, with a sense of destiny, a role model is conscious. It is chosen. It's a sense of control. That's when we say, I want to be like. A role model is consciously chosen. It has a sense of preference and a sense of, if I could be like that. Now notice something here. The greater the overlap between our role model and our gender guiding line, the more at peace we feel. The more at peace we feel. If your father is both your gender guiding line and your role model, you'll be at peace with your development. If your father was your gender guiding line for masculinity, but he wasn't your role model, do you see the shift? The wider the distance between those two circles, the more torn we tend to feel. My father died young, drank a lot, was a nasty man. But there was my Uncle Pete. So I have this sense that if I'm good, work hard, I can be like, but I gotta be careful or I'll turn into, you hear the difference? And we tend to set up that struggle in our heads all the time. Should there be no role model to offer us the alternative, we might have to pick a role model of the other gender, mom, an aunt. And then we will have issues about our masculinity and what it means. If I had an Uncle Pete, at least I can still see an alternative way to be masculine. Everything I'm saying about fathers applies equally to mothers. We grow up, if our gender guiding line for what femininity is our mother, could be a grandmother, could be a big sister if mom dies, but if it's our mother, I hope she's also our role model for women. If she is, that's great. If she isn't, if father, follow me now, stayed with mother, our gender guiding line says real men should stay married to this kind of woman. But mom wasn't our role model. Our teacher was. Our aunt was. We may say, I should like women like the teacher. But for some strange reason, I'm drawn to women like, because to fulfill my gender guiding line, I should be like father. And he stayed with a woman like this. And you hear Bono's song from U2, I can't live with or without you. I don't understand. Why do I stay with you when you're not the kind of woman I should be with? So that's what gender guiding line means. We are setting the pace and the tone for masculine expectations for our children, male and female. We can't help it. You can't avoid it. Does this make sense? It's there. I hope we are also, what? The role model. I hope we are. So they don't feel that kind of tear. How this plays out becomes really interesting when you look at overlap and this notion. You see, if I want to be a role model for my son, for my daughter, as well as a gender guiding line, I have to work with cultural expectations, marital expectations, my expectations. And I have to remember that children are affected as much by what they perceive as by what they learn. Let me make the distinction. We have two children, a six-year-old and a five-year-old. They're brothers. And they decide today's the day they're going to learn how to swear. The six-year-old says, I got it. I'm going to say the word damn, and he giggles. The five-year-old says, no, I got it. I'm going to say the word ass, and he giggles. And just then, mom yells, come on down for breakfast, kids. They run down the hall, jump up on their stools, stare at mom with innocent faces. And mom looks at the six-year-old and says, good morning. What would you like for breakfast? And all bright and smiley, the six-year-old says, good morning. Give me some Cheerios, damn it. And without skipping a beat, she smacks him in the mouth. He cries, falls off his chair, runs down the hall, slams his bedroom door in a huff. She looks at the five-year-old and says, and what would you like for breakfast? And the five-year-old says, I don't know, but you bet your ass it won't be Cheerios. What message was mother intending to send? Don't swear. What did the five-year-old hear? Don't ask for Cheerios. I am a clinical psychologist. I also do marriage and family therapy. I cannot tell you my 32 years in the field how often I have found that the message we send is not the message they hear. They may have learned something, but not what we think they learned. In this silly example, the young boy is learning Cheerios and is not attaching significance to the swearing. We have to be careful. I think I'm teaching my daughter X. She may be perceiving and learning Y. So the funny thing about gender guiding lines, They're not discussed. As I said, it's nonverbal. They simply observe. We can discuss and ought to. Honey, do you know why I do this? What do you think I'm doing? So I will often be in session with a dad, a daughter, a mom, a son, and I'll say, why are you so mad at your father? And the boy will say, he thinks I'm a moron. And I'll say, what makes you think he thinks you're a moron? He asks me every day if I've done my chores. So I'll pull Dad aside, or he'll be right there. I'll say, Dad, do you ask him? Of course I do. Why? It's because I love him. I want to keep him out of trouble. Mom gets mad if he doesn't. So Dad is doing it in order to be helpful. Son is hearing, you don't trust me to do it on my own. So the gender guiding line may be developed. Men are skeptical. Men don't trust. You hear that? And once that starts, it's real hard to change it. So the quick cure for this is a lot of talking, a lot of talking, a lot of talking. Now, in order to talk, we're going to have to look at this second thing here. This is a real clear difference still in men and women. All of you in this room, raise your left hand. Do this. You see, one of the big problems dads still have more than moms is we tend to talk at and to children, not with. This is one of the areas we haven't seen a lot of change in the research. I don't know why, except for one curious phenomenon. Women, moms, are becoming more like us. Instead of us moving more towards some middle ground in communication styles, women are becoming more masculine in their styles and no more effective with children. I'm going to oversimplify. The biggest difference we find, women tend to listen far more to their children than men do. Mothers will ask questions and listen. Dads tend to ask questions and interrupt. Dads tend to ask leading questions. Mom, open-ended. You come home, Kevin. You had a conflict with a teacher. A mom is likely to say this to you. What happened? A dad will say, well, you're being a pain in the ass again. Do you hear the difference? Cheerios. And I will look in the book and say, I did ask him what was going on. What this comes down to is a curious little thing. Let me talk about emotion coaching and how dads get in trouble with this. And then you'll see a curious bit of research with boundaries and play that we're going to get into a little later, that dads still do. When you talk about children, children, listen to this number. Alison Gopnik came up with it. I read it 25 years ago. I'm still blown away by it. Alison Gopnik did some research out at Berkeley, and she found that 80% of what we learn in our entire lives, we learn before we're 3 years old. What percentage? 80. Children are information vacuums. It takes the next 80 years for us to learn 20%. Or as William James, a very famous psychologist at Harvard in the 1890s wrote, most people think they're thinking when in reality they're simply rearranging their prejudices. Interesting quote. You see, what seems to happen during those first 3-4 years? Our brains are wired for everything. Children under the age of 5 can learn any foreign language without an accent. They adopt the accent of the people they're talking to. Children under the age of 4 have perfect pitch. If you do not stimulate these connections, they fade. It's called specialization and lateralization. So if you don't take Spanish at 3-4 years old, you may learn Spanish at 7 or 8, but you'll always speak it with an English accent, an American accent, and it'll be harder. If you don't take voice lessons and practice singing and keep singing, you will have to relearn pitch to hear tone, and you may not be able to do that again. As the brain is so diverse, it's inefficient. Everyone hear that? It's inefficient. What we know as a habit takes practice. All that means is this truism: neurons that fire together wire together. The more you use it, you build up connections, so you no longer have to think about it. That's a habit. In athletics, they call it professionalism. They don't have to think about which hand to dribble with. They don't have to think about how to run a route. They don't have to think about how to juggle a soccer ball, because they've been doing it so long, the brain is wired to automatically go that way. And when that happens, we're proficient. For proficiency to take place, you have to use it. So what happens in the first 3 to 4 years of life, your neurons get pared down to the most efficient routes. And the ones you don't use fade. They do not die. They thought they did. New research from a man amongst others named Richard Amen, A-M-E-N, shows that new learning takes place into your 90s. Neurons still grow. Alzheimer's patients can still learn new things. It never stops, but just at a slower rate. One of the interesting things we do, and we don't realize this, is we train people to not be self-aware. To not be self-aware. Let me explain. All of you, right now, laugh at my drawing, because this is going to be bad. I acknowledge it's bad. Deal with it. This is a brain. This is the ear, and here are your eyes. Got it? Down the middle of the brain, you have something called the corpus callosum. It's a nerve bundle which separates the two hemispheres, left and right. Now, I'm going to oversimplify. I know it's oversimplification. Bear with me. For most people who are right-handed, that's well over 90% of the population, the left side of your brain controls the right side of your body. And the right side of your brain controls the left. That's lateralization. They're not exactly sure why that happens, except the newest research the last 5 years seems to be that even fetuses have right and left hands. Preferences, in other words. The fetus will continually suck only one thumb, not the other. In studies with twins and triplets, they will play with one hand with each other, not the other. We don't know why. If you're left-handed or ambidextrous, go away and die. You screw up all our research, because your brains are wired differently. We'll get into that another time if you're interested. But the importance now is this. For most of us, speech and language is controlled here, from in front of your ear to behind your ear, Broca and Wernicke's area. Emotions and visual spatial are mostly controlled here. Same place, other side of the brain. When we tend to be logical and rational, we tend to use this side of the brain. When we tend to be more emotional and intuitive, we tend to use this. Now, if you got 2 minutes, I'll explain what that means and how dads play into this. If I tell you 2 plus 2 is 5, how many of you know that's wrong? on a PET scan or a functional MRI, positron emission tomography, or a functional magnetic resonance image, when I say 2 plus 2 equals 5, this part of your brain lights up, the logical analytic section. But if I come in the room and say, yeah, I'm real happy in my career. Did you get a sense? I didn't mean that. But there was nothing linguistic in it. Did you hear it? You picked up something intuitively from a gesture, from a tone. Do you hear? That's the other side, the nonverbal. That is right here. There's something where you say, something's not right. The people who are real good at picking up emotions, attitudes, posture, have a very well-developed right hemisphere, and they're not afraid to use it. All children are superb at that. Children under the age of 4 are better lie detectors than detectives and police officers. They can read it because lateralization hasn't quite taken place yet. We rely too much on left hemisphere language, especially in this culture. And most of us develop what's called mind blindness. We're not aware of other people's emotions. Now, how does this happen? Let's look at infant research. It's fascinating. You have a dad, and the dad goes with the newborn. This is videotaped research. If it weren't videotaped, it'd be hard to pick it up. He's holding the newborn, and the newborn is crying. Now watch this. Dad number one looks at the newborn and goes, shh, shh, it's okay, it's okay. Watch me closely as I do it. Shh, it's okay, it's okay. Everyone notice that? I may change the diaper, feed the bottle, as quickly as any other parent. This child won't calm down. Second dad comes in, minority. Very few dads do this. No one knows why. And does this. Oh, it's okay. Oh, it's okay. Oh, I know it hurts. Did you notice a difference in body language and in tone? What was the difference?
Empathy. But why did you say minority?
Like 4%, 6% of the dads tend to do this. The vast majority of dads don't do it.
I know, but that's in all. But that's in all.
No, he meant a minority, a small group of
Oh,
statistically, not racially.
Yeah,
no, it's a minority of dads. We don't know why. We don't get it. The majority of moms behave like the second. You hear this? The minority of moms don't. Now, that child calms down significantly faster in the second group. It's as if in the first group, I'm stiff, my tone is neutral to slightly irritated, and I am saying, you as the infant must come to me. You meet me at my emotional state, and I'm literally telling the child, calm down. The second dad is saying, I will meet you at your emotional state. And that child will tend to latch on to that dad and calm down. I will match that child's breathing rhythm, body temperature, pulse and heart rate. And as I calm my rate down, what happens to that child's rate? It calms down. That is the beginning of what has now become known as emotion coaching. Children's ability to soothe themselves has to be borrowed like an immune system. Children don't have a very well-developed immune system. They need to develop one. They don't have the ability to soothe themselves. They need to get it from. But what we're tending to find, the more and more dads are getting involved in early stage parenting, the children aren't learning this because the dads start telling the child how to feel instead of empathizing and matching how the child feels. Moms tend not to do this. Now, again, there are literally dozens of theories why, but they're all theories. Let me show you a neurological one for a moment. We're going to take that brain and we're going to look at it in a side view. Here's the spine. Here would be the eyes. Wernicke's area and Broca's area are up here. Now, you have right around here a structure called the reticular activating system. And in the reticular activating system, near it, is something called the septal region with the amygdala. These, with the hippocampus, control emotion, body temperature, sleep-wake cycles. They're primitive. They're there at birth. The amygdala is about the size of my thumb. It has projections at birth that go here, like this. Goes to the top of your brain and spindles out. The top of your brain controls action, the motor strip, the parietal lobe, amongst other things. In other words, we are hardwired that when we feel something, what must we do with it? Act on it. Does this make sense?
Yes.
You have to. If you're cold, you have to shiver. If you're hungry, you have to cry and eat. If you're scared, you have to scream to get protection in. So our emotions control behavior. What we find is that very early on, from about, listen to this number, 6 or 7 weeks, how old?
6 or 7 weeks.
We start a process of neural pruning that goes like this. The projections start to go up. And then they start to branch to here, and then back up. In other words, instead of just going to the motor strip, guess where they go?
To the left side of the brain.
Words, language. It starts. It used to be thought that it doesn't start till 2 years. No, it starts around the time the child is starting to begin learning to sleep on his own or her own. And the decisive factor seems to be this. We start attaching words to feelings. It's okay, I know you're mad. Oh, it's all right, you're hungry. Oh, you're so tired, you're so sleepy. You hear that? Parents that do that encourage the brain to make those connections. And when you do, those children begin to be able to slow down and attach words to feelings and inhibit themselves. Slow down. Parents that don't encourage that, the projections continue to go, guess where? And those children continue to act on what they feel. And they can't tell how they feel. You'll say, how do you feel? And the child goes, because he doesn't have words for his own feelings, guess what else he lacks words for?
Others.
So we see these two syndromes, phenomenon, inhibition and empathy, switch. They're not inhibited. They don't slow down. And they don't have empathy. Hence, you got two-year-olds hitting people. That's perfectly normal when they're angry. You hear that? But if they're doing it at 4, at 5, you'll start to find they also have toileting problems. You hear they can't inhibit themselves? They still have trouble sleeping through the night? Any impulse they get, they have to what? Act on. When moms do this, add words to feelings, it has a decent effect. But women tend to do it all the time. The decisive factor is, guess what, gentlemen? When dads do it, it has such a profound effect. and you can more easily pull your upper lip over your forehead than get most dads to do this on a consistent basis. So, first name, sir?
Mazin.
Mazin?
Mazin, yes.
Yes. You're 3 years old. Pretend you're going, right now. This is what dads like to do. Stop it. Stop. Calm down. Remember this? He won't calm down. Mom will come in and tend to say, what are you mad about? Talk to me. Use your words. Now, where moms make a mistake is they spend too much time on empathy. You hear that? Too much time processing. That's another workshop. But when dad comes in and says, Mazin, shh, come here. Now, where am I going with body posture? And I'm going, what are you so mad about? Talk to me. Watch, the child freezes and locks in and goes, you hear that? Say, it's okay, tell me what you're mad at. No, you can't throw that. If you do, you're in trouble. Did you hear I set the limits? Of course I did. But first I empathized. First I paused. And that teaches the child to latch on to my nervous system. And together we calm down. Dads just won't do this. You see it in tapes all the way up to adolescence. With their adolescence, they'll say, what'd you do again? Again, the leading closed-ended question almost. As opposed to saying, talk to me, tell me why you're mad. How do you feel about this? Encourage those neural connections. Dads are horrible at it. When they do it, it has outstanding results. Outstanding. We're not sure why. I can give you guesses, but we're not sure why. It may simply be two phenomena. Number one, it doubles the effect as when mom does it.
Yeah, I've heard.
Mm-hmm. Or I call it the Santa Claus syndrome. I want to get to the third and give you some exercises, but very quickly. Anybody here know mathematics or statistics? All right, bear with me. Yes. My condolences for learning it. If I want to get a representative sample of the best restaurants in LaGrange, what would be the ideal number?
The entire population?
He nailed it. You do know it. It's called Cohen's analysis. The larger the effect size I want to find, the bigger the sample size has to be. The smaller the sample size, what tends to happen? The more significance insignificant material may take. In other words, if I only go to one restaurant, anything in that restaurant becomes how important? Too important. It may be misrepresentative. So here's what, and this research is starting to change. Here's what we think might happen. Because dads have fewer data points per day than moms do with children, in any given day, a mom may have, I'm pulling this number out of my butt, 500 data points. You hear that? So any one transaction mom has with the child means
less.
Dad may only have 50. So every action he has may carry
greater weight.
You hear that? So this may be why emotion coaching seems to be more effective with dads, because once you get past maternity or paternity leave, dads tend to still pull away, though it's changing, so their actions may carry more significance. Now I got to loop back and show you. Remember this. Socially, economically, politically, there are single family, parent families. I was raised in one. My father died when I was 5 years old. I know that. Psychologically, you always grow up in a two-parent household. If you have a dad through divorce, military service, death, who leaves, is not present, do you understand? His impact becomes greater. If I have mom for 17 years, how many data points potentially might that be? So any particular action she has doesn't carry any significance. If I only have dad a limited amount of time, a mythology develops. And if dad divorces, remarries, goes military, leaves, and is gone for long periods of time, the few data points I have become monster. So dads who are disengaged, not very involved, tend to carry even bigger proportion of the gender guiding line than dads who are actually there all the time. So little things I have vague impressions of from my father. My mother, almost 5 years deceased, used to look at me and go, "That's your father, I can't believe it. I can't even believe you remember that." Make sense? That may be why when dads do this, emotion coaching, and all emotion coaching is, you hear me, get down on the kid's level, match his feelings. Don't go too factual. Left brain, don't do that too much. Stay, I know it's upsetting. I get mad too. I don't blame you. I hate when my sister used to steal my toys too. It's okay to get mad. It takes about 30 to 45 seconds. Then go, now how can we do it differently? Now what would be the right thing to do? And children respond. The neural connections grow. Any questions?
Yeah, I do have one.
Please, sir.
You mentioned earlier about how a lot of this stuff is set when they're really young.
Mm-hmm.
What if you're trying to, not necessarily make up for lost time, but say, yeah, I did some of these things wrong. What do you do now that they're, say, teenagers?
Keep doing it. I'll give you two people to look at right now. Check out anything by the man named Richard Amon. He shows you wonderful actual brain scans of even adults and how they change throughout the lifespan. Check out Jeffrey Schwartz. He also has in his books, these are all user-friendly books, where you can look at brain scans of people learning when parents change their things, when therapists talk differently and teach them a different language. You're actually rewiring the brain, even into late adulthood. If you want to read some theory behind this, let me give you two books. Daniel Goleman, G-O-L-E-M-A-N. G-O-L-E-M-A-N. Check out these two books, Emotional Intelligence and Social Intelligence. These two books. Well, he will get into the brain physiology. And yes, it overrides genetic predisposition. Did you hear me? The Human Genome Project is not what they thought it would be. How many of you have heard much out of the Human Genome Project in the last 5 years? They thought they nailed it because they were searching to map the genome. They gave 20 years to do it. They finished it in about 8 because we had 50% fewer genes than they thought we did. And that was a problem. Think statistically again. The model's called OGOD, O-G-O-D. One gene, one disease is what they were hoping to find. Mm-hmm. It rarely, if ever, works that way. It appears to be that no gene, except for things like Huntington's, chorea, and a few other things, there is no genetic direct link between one gene and a predisposition. It appears to be a patterning of genes, the way the genes interact and connect. So they had a few years ago some really interesting research about a gene that was linked to cancer. They found a way of chemically turning it off, and the subjects went blind. Because in another section, that gene linked with, and controlled vision. You hear that? So they might get rid of your cancer, but you would go blind. A few years ago, thanks to some research in England, they found the FOXP2 gene linked to language development. And it was a breakthrough. Everybody's popping champagne because language controls so much of learning. And then some researchers in Sweden found the FOXP2 gene exists in mice. They don't speak. They barely squeak. So the FOXP2 gene is partially linked to speech, but obviously it has many other functions we don't understand. And it's not having that gene, which is the key. It's that gene combined with. Your genes, as you will read in Daniel Goldman's stuff, only present possible patterns. It takes the environment to turn on those genes or turn off, because they can be turned off in years, not even centuries. Years is the newest research. How are we doing? Is this okay?
Great.
So far, two things. Fathers set up timetables and expectations about what masculinity means. Women can't do it. And in an ideal family, you should set up that the gender guiding line is also the role model. What you expect from that half of the human race should also be what you want to be. Otherwise, we tend to internally feel conflicted, torn. And next, dads, because of our emphasis on problem solving, we tend to too quickly jump in and want to talk rationality, logic, which is great. We should do that, but we're raising a generation, several, of emotionally blind kids who are not used to looking inside themselves and in others. And dads seem to hold the key more than moms. Again, ladies, you tend to get it right. You do encourage them to understand feelings, but it's not enough. The men also have to do this. But as I warned you earlier, ladies, you're becoming more like us. Each study, more problem-focused. Third, dads seem to be superb or horrible at establishing boundaries. Let me explain. The interesting research has to do with, what's this word? Now, let's tie these together, and I'll show you how this comes out. I don't know how much time we'll have to get into work distribution and the funny things about that. But just to give you a hint, labor. When most children see their fathers, it's after when?
After work.
So what do we tend to do? Sit down, relax. So it is quite common that gender expectations, they start to think women work harder than because they don't see us do it. That's another whole thing I'll get into a little later if we have time. But that again is changing, very much so. But the one that doesn't seem to be changing is the play. I need to be able to touch someone. I promise it's just play. Ready? Can you get me? First name?
Steve.
Michael, you're 2 years old. I'm starting to tickle you. Ready?
Laugh.
Now give me the signal that says stop. One dad will tend to do this. Go. Cool.
Yeah.
The vast majority of dads will do this. Go. Oh, come on, lighten up. Do you hear that?
Yeah.
Thank you. You see, they watch roughhousing. And again, no one is exactly sure why. Women don't roughhouse with kids. We don't know why. Have you ever seen a woman really roughhouse, throw the kids her? We don't know why. Men, we see them as footballs. Goal! We wrestle, we tumble. There are theories why that get into something called evolutionary biology. We don't have time. But men tend to roughhouse. Men, the majority, blow past the signals to stop. The kid is hurt. We say, rub dirt on it. Get back on it. They're starting to cry and say, stop. We keep tickling him. We give him one more, two more. And the kids start to develop poor boundaries. What that means is emotional signals and verbal signals to stop become disregarded. Do you hear that? There is some fascinating research that children who have fathers who stop when the signal says stop have much more stable friendships through middle school and high school. Can you see what the connection seems to be? They don't annoy the crap out of people. When Steve We're in second grade in the cafeteria, and I flip something at him, and he laughs the first time. I go to flip the second, and you say,
knock it off.
And I what? Or even better, I go up to Kevin, and I go to give him a wedgie, and he gives me that look, and I go, I shouldn't even reach for him. But the kids that are emotionally blind, not used to reading signals, or they read the signals and attach no significance to it, he's got foam coming out of his mouth, his hair is standing up, his tail is back, and I go, he's the good one to give the wedgie to. I give him the wedgie, he rips the flesh from my arm, gnawing on it, and I go, what the hell happened? I was just joking. Because of this emotional blindness, there is a connection to how the dads handled first the roughhousing, and guess what the second is? Can you see it? Emotions didn't mean anything. So they become insensitive to the cues their peers give. And when that happens, all sorts of interesting trouble begins. It is important for children as much as we can to make them inner controlled, self-directed, but not at the expense of ignoring others. If I feel like slapping you in the head, that's okay if I can read you to know you won't mind. And if you do send out the signal, sir, that you do mind, I should go to, because you and I are buddies and you don't mind if I come up and I slap you on the head. It is amazing how many kids can't tell that. You know where you see it most commonly. What am I pointing to? And classroom. They can't tell what teachers to horse around with and what teachers they can't. What teachers they can be a minute late to class, and what teachers? And they just think all teachers are. And and you say, you don't know Mr. Smith by now? I have an adolescent. The one class he decided to goof around in is the one teacher who's been busting his chops all year. And his standard answer to me is, what does it matter? One teacher's no different from the next. Now, ladies, unfortunately, you don't get a pass at this. You just tend to hit this much later. Women are superb with middle schoolers on down at reading the emotional cues. You have wonderful boundaries when it comes to this. Hence, a lady will walk in to your kitchen who's gained 5 pounds, and you'll say, Marge, it's good to see you. And completely what? Ignore the 5 pounds.
Yeah.
Dad will be in the kitchen. His buddy walks in who's gained 5 pounds, says, Bob, you're getting fat. What the hell are you pigging out on? And Bob's self-esteem goes what? You hear that? Well, I was just... Ladies, you know this. Now, hit yourself in the head when I say this, ma'am.
Okay.
Until you have pre-adolescent children.
Mm-hmm.
Then this goes out the windows. And the roles switch. Dads tend to get this better than moms for pre-adolescent and adolescents. An adolescent boy will come home and be in a bad mood and slam his door. And what will dad say?
Leave him alone.
Leave him alone. What did he say? He sent out the signal to what? And moms will be outside the door going, okay,
yeah,
okay, talk to me. Mm-hmm. Come on, tell me. And moms will what? Keep. And they're even worse with daughters.
Mm-hmm. Oh, don't get me started.
Somehow you have a brain fart at that stage. Mm-hmm. We have it early on, what my wife calls MSA, mini stupid attacks. But we know maybe it's something they're getting near our size. We're starting to see them almost as humans. Mm-hmm. It could be that women are afraid to let go. But adolescent and pre-adolescent moms blow through these boundary signals and they start digging and they won't give the kids space. And you will often find in adolescents, they start pulling away from mom and are better able to talk to dad. Because all of a sudden it's as if dad's caught on. Listen to the signals. And again, we see it in pre-adolescents. I'm sorry, ma'am, are you okay? Look at her hide her head. Mark, this is what and this is the thing. Dads in adolescence do catch on, and we're not sure why. Teach your wives. The signal will be there when the kid wants to what? Now, I'm obviously not talking the extreme, drug use, and I'm not talking that, because I'm talking fairly normal development. Respect their boundaries. And as you heard me say, you see this also with division of labor. Many dads think they work all day. When they come home, they should relax. Mom, in the evenings, overtime. Weekends, double time. Holidays?
Triple time all day.
I don't know. There's a book called, oh, it's gone, The Price of Motherhood. Her name is Ann Crittenden, has written this. It's old, it's from 2001 now, where she updated it. It was originally 1998. This is a socio-political book. One of the arguments is how, she's a journalist, not a psychologist, women and mothers should be eligible for Social Security. But the argument has traditionally been they don't contribute to the economy. And what she shows in 1999 and then 2001, 1998 and 2001, dollars. Do you know how much, gentlemen, we would have to pay with two children to have someone do what a mom does per year?
It's like $110,000 or something
like that. You're not even close, sir.
More? Per year, is it?
Per year. Over $200,000. Shopping. You don't have to tell her anything, sir, except, and they got you now on tape. I warned you when you came in. So what they find is that, you think about it, they do most of the overnights, weekends, overtime, shopping, cleaning, shall I keep going? You hear this? Running errands, organizing schedules. If we had to pay nurses, cooks, valets, all of this, it's $200,000. And one of the things to say in the book is, before you're too ready to assume these women are not generating
income,
of course they are. But it's one of the things she calls in this book the hidden economy, which can't be quantified. From a psychological point of view, what this plays out is many children develop gender guidelines and poor boundaries in that they feel when they come home from school, what should they be able to do?
Watch TV.
Especially what gender? The little masculine boys. And I find this all the time. The girls, not as much. They're willing sometimes to come down and help out. The boys feel like, I got home from
work.
Mm-hmm. And it's my weekend. Why should I have to? How many of you are smiling? You hear the argument. It's the same thing. And we haven't realized it's all of the above, bleeding on down. There's a lot more I can say, but has this been helpful?
Yes.
Let me sum up then. Four very basic points to walk away with. Think about. We often, especially us gentlemen, have mind blindness. We're not aware of the significance of our actions, and just because we may have fewer data points with these kids doesn't mean they don't carry significance. Of course they do. We have to be aware of not only what we do, but how what we do might be perceived. We have to realize, number two, that as long as we're carrying the gender guiding line for masculinity, we want to make sure they understand that they're getting a version of masculinity we want them to have in terms of timetables, expectations, all sorts of things. Number three, we have to be able to stimulate the brain to process feelings, not just actions or problems. So your wife comes home after a long day and she's been driving and she says, ah, traffic was horrible. Say that to me, sir.
Traffic was horrible.
What road did you take? Throughout a road. Say Ogden.
Ogden.
You took Ogden at rush hour? Why didn't you jump over to, do you hear what I just did? Right hemisphere to left. I went logic, brain. Did I at once acknowledge his feelings?
No.
You were originally, if you're my wife, mad at traffic. Within 3 minutes, you're going to be mad at?
Yeah.
instead of simply saying, oh, you sound frustrated. Oh, that's horrible. Oh, Ogden sucks. You hear that? We do it with kids, too. It's far more important with kids, so they develop that sense of knowing words for feelings and realizing people have it. That's number three. Number four, we have to be very, very careful, especially dads with middle school and younger children, the way we play. Do we push them to throw that football more than they want? Do we tackle them, wrestle them, throw them to the ground, stomp on them, force them to ride the bike even when they're saying, I'm done for the day, my knee hurts, I skinned it, get back on the, you hear that? Yes, there is a place for that. Yes, 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 yes. But, and you got to acknowledge their feelings or they stand to become emotionally blind and poor with boundaries, and they'll do it with their peers, and their peers and their teachers send out signals that I don't want to do this, and they blow through it, and we're responsible.
Friday nights at a comic book shop, I run a...
That's a signal.
I run a group that a lot of teenage boys are in, my freshmen and a lot of their friends. Emotional blindness. How do you address that?
Please tell me you all heard that. Okay, I'm not hallucinating. Yes.
How do you begin to address that as an individual to kind of, you know, for the big kid that's just, you know, keep pushing?
Check out Daniel Goleman's stuff. Brilliant. I will give you one other book. John Gottman, GOTTMAN, The Heart of Parenting. It has been reprinted under a new title, Emotional Intelligent Parenting. It's the same book. You will see wonderful research and exercise. He's from the University of Washington. Daniel Goleman's from Harvard. These are no slouches, where they give you actual step-by-step things to do. Be aware with adolescents, it's getting a little late. It's not impossible, but it's getting a little late. One of the things I roll my eyes at, Steve, is when I get a 16-year-old who's so emotionally blind, the parents say, now turn them on with him, the emotions. And it's like, especially if it's a boy. I think, has this been helpful?
Yeah.
Over here is a list of how to get a hold of me, other topics I speak on. I say this every year. I do not charge for calls. You have a question, you want more references, call me. I love what I do. I will call you back. I will give you more answers. Fair? So it's right there. Peace. Go have fun. We're in here next doing birth order.